Here we go.
Believe me, you've never heard a talk show like this.
I'm sleeping with Joe Carter. By the way, Joe did not touch them all. Yeah.
I have to say, like, your voice is fantastic.
Meet Smitty.
Listen, I'm the brains here.
And Middy.
And I'm the good-looking funny one.
This is the Smitty and Middy Show.
Smitty Mini Show, thank you for tuning in week number two here on RogersTV London. If you didn't see us last week, we're the Smitty and Middy Show podcast. Find us anywhere you get your podcast. Lots of great guests come in the coming weeks. But Middy, a big one this week is we're going to welcome on the Skip from Team Quebec.
Make sure you also check out the Smitty Mini Show on Instagram, Facebook, and the Twitter. The Smitty Mini Show on YouTube. Make sure you go there. Yes, the Skip from Team Quebec, Miss Laurie St-Georges, joins us. Really appreciate you doing that. How was that? How was the French?
That's perfect. Thanks.
Oh, I didn't roll. Laurie St-Georges. How's that? Is that better?
I love the accent. That's perfect.
He said if I tried to do the accent, you'd laugh at me. So I'm glad that
she laughed at me. She laughed at me doing it.
She's been laughing this entire time. She's just a bubbly person. She's gonna laugh no matter what you say.
Yeah, okay. Everyone is funny, you know? Everyone has a funny part. So
but we were talking about it before. That's like I know anyone who speaks French, that's like their worst nightmare is people trying to speak French to you. When you go to Quebec and you try and speak French, it's always like English. We can speak English. You're like, oh, okay.
I feel like my worst nightmare is to talk in English, to talk to people in English, because I always feel like they judge me, but they're like, oh, you're pretty good in English. Like, you don't really have an accent sometimes. I'm like, ugh.
Did you not grow up speaking English partly? Like, when did you learn English?
In school and like playing curling. Like every weekend we're in tournaments, so obviously I have to talk in English, and I have an English player, so, and I had a lot of English player on my team from Quebec, but anglophone, so I practice with them.
interesting. So on the note of curling, obviously
on the note of curling, there'll be a lot of curling, buddy.
Whole interview.
Talk about curling.
We're gonna get into about your career and some of the accomplishments you've had, but we like to start with all of our guests. How did you get into curling yourself? Obviously, it was from a young age, but was it because of your family? Because I know your family curls with you, and your dad was your coach. Is that kind of what got you into curling in the first place?
Yeah, my two parents were actually playing curling, and they played at Laval sur le Lac. And since I was born, I'm like the curling Laval baby kind of thing, you know? So like everyone like took care of me in the past. Like at the curling club, my parents were playing on the ice and they were having a drink after the game. And I was just sleeping on the couch in the curling club waiting for them, you know? But everyone was just like playing with me and having fun with me. And I was watching my parents curl. So yeah, that's pretty much it. I always like grew up with curling in my life. So yeah, I'm like a curling baby, you know, my sister too. So
that's how it goes. Not many people pick up curling just out of the blue.
On
it's
their
usually
own, yeah.
A family thing. You get brought into it and you learn it all the way up. I wonder, obviously, like we're ignorant in Ontario. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. So in Quebec, you know, in Ontario, it's kind of, it's taboo. It's not the mainstream thing to curl. People make fun of you. People don't like, they don't see it as an actual sport. Is it kind of different in Quebec? Is it more of, you know, a recognized sport, if that makes sense?
I feel it's not a recognized sport. Like it's close, or it's not really popular, you know? When people start university, it's really hard for them to continue to play curling at a high level, you know? So obviously you start with like Jeux du Québec, and just be part of Jeux du Québec, it's a big competition, you know, in curling. So obviously you get exposure at Jeux du Québec, but other than that, it's not a really popular sport. It's more popular men's side, but in women, there's no much teams in Quebec. But when you talk to people and you say like, hey, I'm playing curling, you know, like competitive, they're like, okay, you throw the rock, you yell at people, or like you sweep. And I'm like, okay.
That's pretty much the whole sport.
Yeah, exactly. So obviously I'm trying to like explain them and like, hey, you want to come try with me one day? Like we can have a beer and just play. But they're not like mean. They're surprised because oh, like you're playing curling and like you can do competition curling. So they were kind of like awkward about it, but they're more like open, you know, like they want to try it, you know. So at least it's that, but there's not much team in Quebec.
Yeah, I think that's kind of the same over here because Tyler grew up in a family that curled. So him, his brother, his mom and dad, they curled. My family wasn't like that. I didn't curl until, what was that, a few months ago when Tyler took me out for the first time. And like I said, I kind of just had that blind eye that I was like, oh, it's curling. It's not much. But how much fun did I have the first time we went out?
My favorite part was when you got in the hack and you slid out and then you stood up around the hog line and just went, now what? How do I get back? You had no idea how to just slide back. Something so simple.
But you know what? Everyone who tries curling, they're like, oh, it looks so easy. You know, you just slide on the ice and like you throw the rock, like, please, come on. But when they try, they're like, oh, like it's hard, you know, and it hurts the next morning when you first try it.
Yes. Right?
Even
yes.
For me, the first time of the season, when I get on the ice the next morning, I'm sore, you know? So yeah, it's a work in progress.
But yeah, the thing I told him before we went out is that you're going to be sore in muscles that you didn't even know you had. Like the bottom of your foot. The bottom of your foot kills just because you're trying to balance, or your hip flexor. You've never felt your hip flexor before, but tomorrow it is going to feel like you want to rip it out. It hurts so bad.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And even us when, like, you know, we're training a lot, sorry, in the summer, but like it still hurts the first time you go on the ice, like the first time of the year, it's painful. But
yeah, the first time I was out there, like I said, the next probably how long was I before I got back to normal? A couple days.
We were steady drinking through the next.
Yeah, it was painful. It was painful. I wanted to talk a bit about your schooling because I know that you're a journalism major, right? Yeah. So how do you balance, first of all, between being a professional athlete, someone that's curling at all the big events across the country, and being a student at such a young age?
Well, it's hard, you know, because I made a choice early in my career in curling, you know, that I wanted to balance curling, work, and studies. So for now, I'm in school in journalism, but like I take 3 classes per semester, you know. So like it's not a lot, but I can curl like half of the time if I want to, because I made that choice, you know. But it's hard like to see friends and to see other people than at curling, you know. Like thank God my boyfriend is a player, so like we kind of like understand each other. When he's away, I'm like, okay, fine, you know, it's okay. And when I'm away, he's fine with it. We really understand each other. But sometimes it's just tiring, you know, during the full season, like before the Scotties, when there's tournaments, you know, it was sad last year, but usually, I'm at school, then I'm going to practice. I'm doing my ladder game at night, and then I train, and then I work, and then I have to do my homework, and then like it's always the same thing. And then I go in tournaments in the weekends. So it's, my schedule is always full, you know? So like the running joke at the university, it's like mid semester when I come like in a class, they're like, oh, who are you? Like Laurie, it's your name, right? Like, is it your first time here? And I'm like, please. I know, like, because I missed some class, you know, I have no choice because it's, well, I have the choice, but it's my personal choice to do that because I'm a bit like crank with curling. Like I love playing curling, so I will never stop playing. So I'd rather take less classes than stop curling, you know.
Listen, they're just being jealous because they don't kid yourself. They were watching you on TV the whole time, right? They knew probably, where you were.
Probably. It happens to me in junior when we played the final in Shawinigan and we lost the final. I was editing one of my video for one of my class. And there's a guy who was like, hey, I saw you on TV on TSN. Like, it was you, right? It was you playing curling, like throwing the rocks, and you lost, eh? You lost in the final. I was like, yeah, buddy, that's me.
Thanks for reminding me.
Hi. Yeah.
You know? Like, Like you forgot that you lost. Thanks. I forgot.
That's fine. It's part of the experience.
I want to, like, you were just talking about your junior career and obviously a very accomplished junior career, but like, we don't have a whole lot of time with you. And I want to just kind of jump right over that, if that's okay with you. And the 2021 Scotty Tournament of Hearts, you were chosen as a team to go to it due to, you know, no competition happening before that. And the champion team from the year before not being assembled anymore. Yeah. So when you got the word that you were heading to the Scotties and you were making that like almost massive jump into the biggest tournament, curling tournament in Canada, what was that feeling like? What was going through your head when you found out that you were heading to the bubble?
It was crazy. I kind of felt like not bad. It's just like, I love every team in Quebec, you know? And we kind of know each other because it's a small world, especially in Quebec. So I felt kind of bad, like, on the moment, like, oh my God, there's my friends who curled last year and they're not going. But then after that, I was like, okay, so they choose you, not just because they were not together anymore, because you did in the past great things, you know, and you have to be happy for that. And you have to be grateful for that, that they actually choose you to go. And after that, I was just so exciting. I texted all of my girls and like my boyfriend was beside me. And I was like, because he was waiting for his answer too. So I looked at him and I was like, did you get the email? Did you get the email? And he's like, no. And I'm like, are you kidding me? I'm going and you're not. And then he received it and we just start like, well, I started crying. I was like, oh my God, my first one. Like, it's so nice. But it's unfortunate that we didn't play in the provincial, you know. Like, I wish we won that title, but I'm so grateful that we had the chance to go and represent Quebec, and it was an amazing experience.
Yeah, it kind of, you strike me as the type of person that's very, you like the competition, right? So the fact that you didn't get to play everyone and get to prove yourself to go there, you kind of missed out on that by just being chosen, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I wish we could have played, and especially this year, like, it was so hard to not play in tournaments, right? And not, like, practice with your whole team. So, yeah, it was kind of hard to not win it, but I still feel like we deserve it, you know, even if they choose us. I think we deserve it because we did so much great things in the past, and we're really engaged and we're practicing a lot, and like, we're training, we're doing nutrition. So I'm just grateful that we had the chance to go and perform well at the Scotties. So
nobody can second guess how you perform there at all. I mean, I can anticipate that probably from the outside in, they didn't expect you to do as well as you did, and obviously you showed that you guys can compete. I want to ask, how did you stay ready for the Scotties, knowing that, you know, there's no rinks open, and if there are rinks open, you know, there's a lot of rules to it? Because I seem to remember seeing a picture of, I think it was your sister, maybe curling on a frozen pool at your parents' house. Like, so if that's how she's staying in shape, how are you trying to stay in game shape?
Well, like, you could, like, for 1 month and a half before the Scotties, you couldn't go practice in a curling club. But before that, I was at the curling club almost every day. Like, I was throwing some rocks by myself or with Emily, my second, or Felix, my boyfriend. Even at Christmas Day, the 25th, we were on the ice throwing some rocks. Like, we went crazy about it because we had nothing to do when the club was open. If you wanted to practice, you had to reserve it, but still, I reserve every day, you know? So I was there, like, every day practicing, and like, I trained a lot on my apartment. Like, honestly, here it's like my gym. I have my bar right there and my weights like up in there. So here it's like my training room. It's my office. And yeah, my sister, like, my parents did this, and it was actually awesome. I saw it. I had the chance to do like a couple of slides on it, and it was great ice. Like, it was really great ice. My dad did a great job, and it was just fun, you know, to just get the slide in, you know, just the slide. It feels good and like, it keeps you in shape. So yeah, it was great, but it was hard the month and a half before the Scotties to just do nothing kind of thing. So we did a lot of visualization and like training, And for like 30 minutes, I was in my bed, like doing my intern and then doing my outturn. That's it, you know?
Anything you can do to keep practicing, right? To just keep on it. When you did get to the Scotties, we've talked to curlers in the past that were there, right? And they said it was very secluded almost. You're kind of kept to yourself at the Scotties. They didn't really want you mingling with other people. Was the experience for you similar? Were you kind of stuck to yourself once you were in the bubble?
Yeah, well, I think it's especially because I had homework to do. I had a lot of homework to do, and I was like not in midterm, but almost like it was almost the end of my semester. So it was kind of hard for this. But it was our first Scotties, right? And like we're just out of junior, and like in junior, it's really like you don't drink and like you do your thing, you know, and we kind of had this for the Scotties, you know? So like being in the bubble, it was hard because you couldn't like have a drink with the other team and like talk really with the other team and exchange like experience, you know? But we were just so focused on our team that it was kind of great for us, the bubble, you know, for Scotties, because now we played against those teams. And like next year, if we win, well, we know what it is. You know, we saw the logo first thing at the arena. We saw the logo. We were like, oh, this is cool. But yeah, I think the bubble was kind of like a great thing for us.
Now, we like Noah mentioned there, we talked to Wayne Madal, who was in obviously the men's tournament before. And he mentioned how eerily quiet it is, and you could yell down the ice where you couldn't do it before with the crowds there. But I'm wondering, even though you were like junior champion playing in all these junior tournaments and there's crowds there, it's not the Scotties Tournament of Hearts, not the crowd in any way that would be at that tournament. Do you think it was an advantage to you to not have to be thrown into that crowd, into that atmosphere right away, to get your feet wet in this tournament before, you know, seeing the thousands of fans in the crowd?
Yeah, for sure. I think that like in Shawinigan, like it was not like too many people, like not 10,000 people in the arena, but it was a lot of noise, you know. But it's not the same thing. It's not the same vibe, you know. And I think it was a great thing for us because we were able to communicate more and like more clearly, you know. We kind of like all understood each other when we were talking on the ice, and it was just like more calm. You know, when we called a timeout, like no one was really screaming, or like if Innerson made a triple takeout crazy, no one was screaming, and you didn't want to like look on the other sheets because you were just focused on your sheet, you know? So yeah, I think it would be a big difference for the next years if we're going. I hope so. But it's for sure something that we have to improve, to maybe do some sign or like communicate like with specific words, you know, because of a lot of noise. But this year, like you could hear someone in the bathroom just flush the toilet, you know. It was crazy. We kind of like whispered to each other sometimes because it was you could hear everything.
Yeah. Well, it would have been so quiet not having anyone in the building. And then curling itself, if you take away the fans, is a fairly quiet game other than the screaming when you're going down. I wanted to talk about you over the course of the tournament. You and your team became kind of a need to watch, right? People felt the need that you need to tune into this one. Like, they're good. Did you ever get that feeling while you were there that people are watching us, like we're exciting to watch?
Like for myself, not really, because I was just playing and I was really not understanding why people were like crazy about it. You know, I was just being myself. I was just playing curling. I was just having fun with my girls, you know, and no one was in the arena. So you don't really feel it. It was all on social media, so like you don't really feel like, not the pressure, but like the intensity of it, that everyone is like watching. But at one point I was like, why people are just getting crazy about their team, right? We're just having fun. And then I realized and reading comments, I was like, okay, maybe they actually needed this, right? They needed a team who just like play to play and deal with the sloppiness of the team sometimes, because we had bad games, you know, and it was still fun. Like I had the best time of my life there, even if we lost, you know? So yeah, I don't think I felt it, but now I do. Now I do.
That was exactly why you became Canada's team in a way, is because, you know, we're all locked down. We're watching you guys play, and you brought that energy and that fun that, you know, there's professionalism and having fun at the same time, something you don't get to see too much in professional sports. And it was just like you could feel the energy coming through the TV. And as much as you think nobody was watching, there was probably more people watching because everyone was locked down. Like there were millions on millions of people watching you, just not to put a whole too much pressure, but like, remember you're mic'd up. So all I'm saying is don't scream any bad words, because you're going to see millions of people there.
Yeah. It was just crazy, because you just don't realize it. Like there's the TSN crew, you know, in the bubble, and there's a camera watching you, but like, you don't realize it, you know? Yeah. And we were like, just, hey girls, we're playing for us. Like we're here to experience and soak it all in and just live the moment, you know? So we were not really thinking about it. Maybe like midweek, we were like, oh, there's a lot of people watching and like commenting and like requesting like or following whatever. And at this point, yeah, it was exciting, but we still like played for us, you know, and we enjoyed every moment for ourselves.
Just next time you look at that camera at the Scotties, which you will be there again, just look at it and go, that's a million eyeballs right there. That is a million eyeballs.
Do not do that. That is.
And then I want to see the face when it closes it, like, oh, that's a lot of people in that one camera. So you're in an interesting position where you kind of were thrusted, you know, junior into, again, one of the biggest tournaments in the country. And I want to know what the difference is between the junior curlers to the more senior curlers and, you know, some of the most senior curlers in Canada that you ended up actually beating and made your name for beating those big teams.
Oh, it was amazing. Just to play against them, just to be on the same ice and like see every big name there playing against you on the other sheet. It was crazy. The difference between junior and women, if you make one mistake, oof, it's hard. It's really hard. Like they're gonna take this door and like open it right away, you know, and get into it. So that's the biggest difference, I feel like. But like playing against big names, it was fun to play against them. It was amazing. And like after the game, I was like, I just played Chelsea Carey. I just played Holman. It was crazy, you know?
Not only played them, but beat them.
Beat them.
Well, not Rachel. It was close. Yeah.
Not Rachel.
She played
Carey, yeah.
Not a lot of people get to beat Rachel, though.
Yeah. So it was just awesome to play against them. But on the ice, you know, when I have a draw or takeout to do against them or against many points, you know, I was just focused on my team. My girls were like, hey, you got this, you're the best, let's go, we're in it, let's go, enjoy, you got this. So for sure, I like in my heart, I was like, I'm gonna make the shot. They believe so much in me that for sure I'm gonna make the shot. And hey, I made the shot, you know? So it was just awesome energy. And It was just our team, you know, like we really did this for ourselves. And at one point we just said like, enjoy the moment, you know, every rock, enjoy it, you know?
Absolutely.
You never give me that encouragement. You have never once looked at me and said, you got this, you're the best.
Well, and why we don't get to this spot.
And like my team were actually the best for me. Like they really, really put me in a good position. You know, they were always supportive. They were always trusting me. And that's what I need as a player. You know, this is my gas. You know, if you believe in me, I can do anything, you know, and my team gave me that. So that's why it was crazy out there.
We have time for one final question here. And I wanted to ask you, you got to go there and your family was a part of this, right? You had your sister, your dad. How special was that to have them there with you for this experience that you say is the best experience of your life?
It was so special. And I'm so proud of my little sister, you know. She did amazing. And she's only 19. She's going 20 this summer. So imagine competing against Rachel Ullman at 19. It's amazing. And just be there with them and be there with my dad. We had like moments together and it was just amazing. I remember there is the first video of me and the team with the song Let It Go. Yeah, it was a crazy moment. And I texted my dad and I was like, can I come to your room? Like, I can't. I need my dad right now. Like, I need to share this with someone. And I just started crying in the hotel room because I was like, thank God you're there with me, right? Thank God you're there. You're my father at one point. On the ice, you're my coach. No question about this. But it was nice to be like a family there. But honestly, our curling family is it's not just me, my sister, and my dad. It's my whole team, you know. Like, we really love each other and we treat each other like sister, you know. So yeah, it was amazing. I'm so proud of them.
Well, listen, we weren't going to bring up the Elsa thing, but I mean, if Disney ever does a live action, you got it in the bag. You don't even have to show up. Like, you are Elsa. And I could tell you that was probably the proudest moment your dad's ever had. And I'm sure, you know, he was enjoying it just as much as you were. So, Laurie, we really appreciate you jumping on with us here. And when you win a Scotties, remember the Smitty and Middy show, you know.
For sure.
Remember to come back.
On the mic.
Where are you going? Not Disneyland, the Smitty Middy show. That's exactly where I'm going. All right. Thank you very much. Really appreciate it.
Thanks to you guys.
All right. Thank you to Laurie St-Georges. And I think I did it perfectly
your French
there.
French is good.
Thank you.
I think you underestimate yourself sometimes.
Je peux parler français.
Je suis Noah.
that was pretty
je
good.
Je suis un Smitty.
Maybe I should do a show in French because my English.
The French people are going to hate me when they hear that.
No French people were listening. Don't worry. Thank you again, Delay, for jumping on with us. Again, she became Team Canada, basically, at that Scotties Tournament of Hearts. They were a prime time event every time
couldn't
they were on
it.
The ice.
Yeah, you couldn't miss it.
Such a polarizing, even to talk to her. She's bubbly. She's amazing. Well, she's a lot of fun to be around.
And everyone we've talked to, I've never met someone. She's just so excited, right, to be a part of it. She was so thankful that she got to be there.
Well, she's not someone who's been in the limelight for 10 years. She was thrusted into the limelight
this year
overnight because we had nothing else to watch. And people who have never watched curling before were watching curling. But that is it again for us this week. We didn't get a whole lot of time to talk, but if you want to hear us talk, you head to the Smitty Middy Show podcast that is released Mondays at 8 a.m. anywhere you get your podcast. Check out the Smitty Middy Show on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Follow us there, the Smitty Middy Show on YouTube. Give us a follow there as well. Hey, we'll be right back here on Rogers Television London Friday at 6:30. We'll see you then.